God bless you. Thank you for tuning in. I want you to know that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ loves you, and I appreciate you, and I truly thank God for your lives. If you have not listened to the video that I uploaded prior to this one, which is an encouraging video for pastors and those who are in leadership, particularly those who are ministering in small communities or in communities where people know you, people are familiar with you, among your family, among friends, among colleagues, among people who know your past, be it good or bad, I believe that you will find this to be a very encouraging message, the one that I uploaded prior to this one. So when you get a chance, please go back and listen to that and any of the other messages, such as how to teach like Jesus taught. That's very important. I see that the Lord is shifting us into the theme of discipleship. I mentioned to you all previously that I was working on the answers video, although I've already sent out all the answers to everyone who participated in the quiz. If you participate in the quiz and you haven't gotten the answers yet, please PM me. It may be a couple of days, it may be a week before I can get back with you, but please PM me and I will send you the answers to the quiz. The video that I was working on was actually a brief video response with the questions in it, just telling you where you can find the answers in the Bible as far as the scriptures, where I found it in the Mormon teaching and also in the Quran, the answers to the quiz. All right, so but the Lord has been intervening as always. I allow him to do what he wants to do when he's talking to you, because you don't belong to me, I don't belong to you, we all belong to God. Amen. So let him have his way. Other than that, I have nothing to say to you all. I don't know you people. Yeah, I'm just kidding. I love you all, and I feel like I know you, and I know you feel like you know me, right? So I just truly thank God for your lives. So tonight I want to talk to you, or this evening, I want to talk to you about the unprofitable and profitable servant. Are you a useless Christian or a profitable servant of Jesus Christ? Amen. So I just want to briefly share with you, for those of you who may know several of the people who ministered with Paul, the Apostle Paul, throughout his ministry, then when I mention these names, you'll be familiar with them. For those of you who do not know them, I recommend that you go back, and if you have a concordance, go back and just, you know, type in the names and see if you can find, or until you find information about these particular people, and read some of the scriptures and some of the experiences that they had with the Apostle Paul. But tonight I want to talk to you about two people, one of them being Demas, D-E-M-A-S, the other being Mark, which he's also known as John Mark. He's the nephew of Barnabas, so you know Barnabas and Paul traveled and worked together a lot. And sometimes there was contention between Barnabas and Paul. They both were greatly used by God. And on one occasion, I want to talk to you about when Paul and Barnabas basically fell out over Mark, John Mark. And the reason why they had the dispute is because at a previous time, they had traveled to a place to minister. And Mark, who had traveled with them, had basically abandoned them while they were ministering. And so this time they came together and they wanted to go forth and do the work of the ministry. And Barnabas wanted to bring Paul, Mark with him, but Paul resisted. So I'm going to read it to you, the account to you. Let's start in Acts chapter 15, verse 30. All right. It says here, let's start in verse 36. It says, "And some days after, Paul said unto Barnabas, let us go again and visit our brethren in every city where we have preached the word of God, word of the Lord, and see how they do. And Barnabas determined to take with them John, whose surname was Mark. But Paul thought not good to take him with them, who departed from them from Pamphylia, and went not with them to the work." So here it is, Barnabas, the uncle of Mark, John Mark, and Paul were arguing over John Mark. Barnabas wanted to bring his nephew. Paul said, no, we're not going to bring him because he abandoned us in the middle of the work that we were doing in Pamphylia. He just left us. We're not going to bring him along with us. No way. And verse 39 says, and the contention was so sharp between them that they departed asunder one from another. And so Barnabas took Mark and sailed onto Cyprus. And Paul chose Silas and departed, being recommended by the brethren unto the grace of God. And he went through Syria and Cilicia, confirming the churches. Now this is no little thing. Here it is. Barnabas and Paul, who had just had some great big revival, they're working together, they're winning souls, they're following up with the churches that have been established, but now all of a sudden they fall out. They have this big fight that cannot be resolved, cannot be reasoned, even by the brethren, could not intercede and help them, so much that they had to split and go separate ways. And Barnabas took his nephew Mark, John Mark, and Paul took Silas under recommendation of the brethren. Now, we know that things worked out well with Paul and Silas. Even though they ended up in prison, they were singing and praying, and God did great things. Amen? But Paul had made up in his mind that whatever, you know, he had determined in his mind that Mark was no longer profitable for the ministry, and he was not going to waste his time with him. And how many of you know that sometimes we waver in our walk with the Lord? And sometimes people in leadership lack the patience that they need with us. And they're ready to write us off. They're ready to dismiss us. They're ready to just let us go because we've stumbled, because we failed, because we wavered along the way. But I thank God that he's not like man. Amen? Now, we had no idea that Mark would later prove to be profitable. And I'm going to show you this. That the same Paul will later call for Mark. So go with me to 2 Timothy chapter 4. 2 Timothy chapter 4. All right. So now since this split, Paul has also been working with another fellow that he's trained in the gospel, whose name is Demas. You'll see Demas throughout the scripture, as I mentioned. Demas, Titus, Silas, Timothy, these are all people that, and John Mark, that have worked under Paul and so many others. But Demas, who was someone else that Paul had invested so much into, had also made a mistake. Let's read in verse 9 of 2 Timothy chapter 4. It says, do thy diligence to come shortly unto me, for Demas has forsaken me, having loved this present world, and is departed unto Thessalonica. Cretans to Galatia, Titus to unto Dalmatia. Only Luke is with me. Take Mark and bring him with thee, for he is profitable to me for the ministry. Now here it is that Paul, sometime later, is sending for Mark. This very same Mark who had wavered in the faith, but when they called him, we find him back again in Acts chapter 15, verse 38, that he has returned and he's ready to go, and we don't know what made him waver. But Paul had written him off. But now here it is sometime later that Paul is calling for Mark again. See, because he said that Mark was profitable for the ministry. Let me tell you something, brothers and sisters, that should be our aim, that along our way, along the path, along our road of salvation, that we pray that we will become profitable for the ministry. Yes, you may make mistakes along the way. You may stumble, you may waver, you may even just do some stupid things at times. But it's just a part of the growing process of God. It's just a part of growing in the grace of God. Anyone who tells you that they came to Christ and they were just living right from day one, they never made a mistake, they never failed, they never stumbled, they never did any of these things, mark that person. That person is a liar. You can't believe anything they say. They are a liar. The scripture says, if we say that we have no sin, we are liars. Amen? Not to say that we are living in sin, but to say that you have no sin, that you have not sinned, you are a liar. All right? So we are all growing in grace, and we're growing into the perfection that God has called us to. Amen? So whatever it was that made Mark an unprofitable servant in Paul's eyes at one time, and even in his own works, he cannot deny that he didn't abandon them. He was unprofitable. But by the grace of God, he was restored to the body of Christ, and he became a profitable servant of the Most High God. Amen? So let that be our aim, that we will not be as Demas. What made Demas unprofitable is because he had a love for the world. See, he loved the world. There's a difference between stumbling and being a lover of the world. Along the path of life, along the path of righteousness, you may stumble, you may fall, you may make mistakes, you may even sin. I'm not saying that this is a license to do so, but I'm saying that you may do these things. I'm not saying that you have to do these things. But the difference between the one who stumbles is that they are not a lover of the thing that they fell into. Demas was a lover of this world. He never let go of his love for the world. Amen? You cannot love the world and love God. They are opposite. They are opposite. You're going to love one or hate the other and hate the other. You cannot love both the world and God. And Demas loved the world. And the scripture says that he had forsaken Paul, being a lover of this present world. And unfortunately, many Christians are unprofitable servants because they are worldly and they are in love with the things of this world. And church is just some place they come to just relieve their religious conscience. Amen? And therefore, they are useless Christians. And instead of being profitable servants of the Most High God. Yes, they have Christians in title, but they have no profit to the body of Christ. They add nothing to the gospel. When I say gospel, to the work of the gospel, they add nothing to the ministry. They are of no use to the kingdom of God. Now, that may seem harsh, but I will tell you, more than 90% of the people who flood churches weekend in and weekend out are useless to the ministry and to the work of the ministry. More than 90% are useless. And even of those 10%, how many are doing the work out of a pure heart, in a pure motive, to glorify God and to edify Him? Or are they just doing it out of form or fashion, or because their pastor has ordained them, or someone has given them a position, or just for some other selfish motive? Let us lay aside everything that causes us to be a lover of this world, and help us to become lovers of God and to become profitable servants to the kingdom of God. Amen? So, if you find yourself on the road that Demas was on, get off and say, Lord, I don't love you like I should, but I want to. Help me to be a lover of God, that I may lay aside everything that will lead me astray and cause me to forsake you. And if you find yourself as John Mark, where you've made mistakes, you've abandoned the work, dust yourself off, repent, ask God to help you and to fill you and help you to fulfill the call in the ministry that He's called you to. And if you do not know Jesus Christ, the number one call that you need to answer is the call of salvation. I ask you right now to confess your sin, to repent, to turn to God, and say, Lord, save me. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Sanctify me. Cleanse me. Wash me in your blood. Get baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Get a Bible and read it and ask the Holy Spirit to teach you and to lead you in the way in which you should go. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful evening.